little advertising. All right, this will not cost you anything. We're not selling it, okay? So this is a devotional book. It is written by Paul David Tripp. It's called New Morning Mercies. Paul Tripp is a man who has been a very accomplished counselor and pastor, and he can communicate spiritual truths in very effective ways. And Mita and I have taken up reading this every single day. It's according to the calendar. So you start on the day in which the calendar you're in. So today would be the 17th. And you start, that would be where you would begin. And you just go around. And there's something for every single day of the year. And each day that we have been reading this, and we've been reading it for months, God has spoken to our hearts in very, very important ways. So much so that we bought a bunch of these. And we said, we've got to get them out to our congregation so that they might be encouraged in their faith as well. So this is all my opinion. I'm not saying this is God's word, okay? But let me just tell you that it's been really something helpful for us. And there are others that are nodding their heads as if they were to say, we agree with you. So I have four books up here. And you're welcome to take one with you afterwards. If you want to buy one for somebody else, just leave $20 here, okay? And then we will also be buying others as time goes on, because I'd like to have as many people get these as possible. They're very, very helpful and encouraging for an everyday devotional. Well, today we're going to be talking about some pretty hopeful things. That's nice to have a positive message on such a negative week, as we have seen terrible, terrible things. Just the other day, I was reading in the news on the web about a party that's 90 miles north of San Francisco that a father had given his daughter permission to make invitations on public social media, and 150 people showed up. Most of them, they had no idea who they were, and some of them got unruly during the party. And the father told them to leave. Those three young men left, came back an hour or so later, and began shooting at the people at the party. 14 were injured in the process. Nobody killed, but like you get these sort of thing feeling like, what is this world coming to? It appears that we have crossed a threshold where these kinds of things are actually not only acceptable, but expected. Now, I don't say acceptable in the sense that everybody's okay with it, but it's like nobody's so horrified. You get to the feeling that maybe each day somebody's going to be shot. So, you know, the cops down in Dallas who were mowed down by somebody as a sniper. You have the people that were 87 or so that were killed in France by a man in a big truck. And it's like, what is this world coming to? I was talking to a man yesterday who is not a believer, and he said to me, you know what, I believe we're in the end times. He says, I believe that the Antichrist probably is in existence right now. And I had to agree with him. I think that some of those things are quite possible. We are living in a time that things are changing faster and faster every day. And it gets to be a bit frightening, doesn't it? You don't know whether you can be in a large crowd anymore. You don't want to be in a place where there's thousands of people for fear somebody might take out a gun and begin shooting. Well, in the midst of all these things, we're told that God has already let us know about that. He said that in the end days, that the love of many will grow cold, and that they'll be doing things that were never conceived of before, and we're seeing that happen. But he tells us that when these things begin to happen, that we should be keeping our eyes looking upward, because our redemption is nigh. He says there is hope for those who know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, who have confessed their sins and trusted in Christ's work on the cross, who have become part of the church of God and are looking for his return, because the Bible teaches that when he returns, he will take his own to be with himself. As we have read in Revelation, there are certain things that we will be protected from the judgments that God will bring upon the earth, and some of them are incredibly severe, and that he will in one, at the end times, bring us back to be with himself and take us to a place that he calls heaven, he calls home. And we're going to be talking about that today. In the passage that we read this morning in Revelation chapter 21, don't turn there because we're not going to spend the majority of our time in that place. Actually, we may not even get there. But there are things that you have to understand before you get there in order to understand how those things are so wonderful. So turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In Revelation, he tells us that he's making all things new. Boy, wouldn't that be great to have all things new? I'm kind of tired of how things are right now. And it's a saddening thing, the way we treat each other. The divisions in our country between races and the disrespect that young folks are showing to older folks. And the disrespect different people are showing to one another just because they're different. I'm looking for a time when things will be made new. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, before we can even experience the things that God is going to do in Revelation chapter 21, we have to be made new. We ourselves have to be made new. Now that process has already begun. If you have come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and have been born again, already something is new about you. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I stay where you are in 1 Corinthians, okay? But in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, these words are written. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. And that's really the challenge. Is not to take on the world's view of things, which is hopeless. Many people are kind of hoping that these kinds of things will pass and somehow or another will go into a new cycle and will bring order out of chaos and things will get better. They're not going to get better. But our spiritual point of view is that we are waiting for one who is coming to bring us home. But we are to be busy during this time in bringing others to know him as well. So we don't regard anyone from the worldly point of view, though we once regarded Christ in this way. We don't do that any longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that means if anybody has been joined to Christ by the Holy Spirit in salvation, he is a new creation. That's something new about us already. That's something that's already happened. And if you've been born again, God says that you are a new creation, new spiritually. And that doesn't mean that it's kind of like a ethereal kind of thing. But there's actually something about you as a person that has been made new. The Holy Spirit has come to dwell within you. And you've been given a new nature. You have your old nature as well that contests with that. But you have a new nature so that you can indeed serve God the way Jesus did. You remember that Jesus walked on this earth as a man, totally as a man, but also in submission to the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit of God worked through him, leading him into the wilderness at the beginning of his ministry to be tempted by the devil for 40 days and 40 nights. The Holy Spirit was the one who gave him the ability to do miracles. Jesus did these things by the Holy Spirit. He raised people from the dead by the Holy Spirit. And so you may wonder, wouldn't it be nice? I mean, why did we have to do it this way? Why couldn't, if he's going to make all things new, if he's going to make us into a new creation, couldn't he have just given us a new spirit and given us a new body? How many of you would really like to have a new body now? Yeah. Is there anybody that wouldn't? I think I'd probably get less names. All right. So, yeah. So, why is it that he didn't just give us that new body as well at the same time? Well, the kind of body that we're going to be talking about would not be appropriate for us to have here on earth and live amongst everybody else. You see, Jesus became one with us, dwelt among us. He became a man. And so also We are still in the bodies that we have, so we can relate with everyone else. We're no better than them. We're just been given forgiveness through Christ, given the Holy Spirit that enables us to obey God. And we have the opportunity then to share with others how they can come into that experience too. So we needed this same old body, which will contend with us the whole way until we die. But we have a new thing, which is that new nature given to us by the Holy Spirit. We're told in Ephesians chapter 1 that this Holy Spirit dwelling within us is intended to give us hope. We sang about that. There is a hope. Indeed, there is. And that is also in the fact that the Holy Spirit dwells within us. He is the one who gives us hope. And it says, having believed, you were marked in him with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who was a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the day of the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. So he's telling us that if those who have been born again, who have the Holy Spirit living within them, and see his working through them, changing them, turning them away from sin and seeking to serve other people, those are things that give us that confidence, that assurance, that the other things that are promised in our inheritance will also be given to us as well. So we have something new too already. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul talks about the resurrection body. That is the body that is required for us to have if we are going to exist in heaven. And so we read in 1 Corinthians 15, beginning with verse 35. There he is posing questions that people might have who might say, you know, that's unbelievable. We've never seen anything like that. What are you talking about, Paul? Somebody will ask, well, then how are the dead raised? If there is resurrection, and Paul has spent the first half of this chapter arguing that there is a resurrection, that Jesus was raised, and as a result of his resurrection, so also will those who believe in him be raised as well, bodily raised. Well, the objection then, what is that body going to look like? Who wants a dead body to be raised out of the ground that's been decaying for such a long time? You remember the story of Jesus going to the tomb of Lazarus, and he says, roll away the stone. Martha says, Lord, why do we want to roll away the stone? He's been in there 4 days. He smells terrible. And he says, didn't I tell you that you would see the glory of God? And so they rolled the stone away, and he called Lazarus out, and he was resurrected. He was given life. Not the same kind of resurrection we're talking about here, but definitely tells us why they're asking the question, is that the body that's going to be raised? Because Lazarus then, he died again later in his life. He was given life, but then that was lost, like we all lose it naturally. Well, he says, now let's just think about this. First, his argument is this. God changes the form of things all the time at their death. He changes the forms of things all the time. We see it around us in creation all the time. In agriculture, we see this happening consistently. Verse 36, he says, how foolish for you to think that God couldn't do something like this. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. So you take a seed, you put it in the ground, and it dies. And when you sow, you do not plant the body that will be. In other words, you don't take a flower and stick it in the ground in order to get a flower. You take a seed. So you're not planting that which is going to be, you plant the seed. So you don't plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or something else. But God gives it a body. God is the one who has given it a body that he has determined. And to each kind of seed, he gives its own body. So he's saying you put the seed into the ground, and what comes up is not another seed, but a body that God has determined that seed will always produce. So God is able to make those kinds of changes. You can put something in the ground and something else will come out of it. Well, so it is also with the body. He says, Now, all flesh is not the same. Let's just talk about another thing here. He says, God creates a great variety of bodies, not all the same. And what he can do with plants, he can do with anyone. All flesh is not the same, he says in verse 39. Men have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds have another, fish have another. There are also heavenly bodies and there are earthly bodies. God has tons of options that he can use. He can make any kind of body that he wants to. So not only can he put something in the ground and something else comes up, but he can determine with a great variety as to what is going to come up. There are many different kinds of bodies. And then he speaks about the splendor of those bodies because he can make things have a different splendor. It can go into the earth one way and come out with great glory. It can go in weak and come out powerful. He says, but the splendor of the heaven bodies is one kind. The splendor of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of splendor, the moon another, and the stars another, and the stars differ from stars in splendor as well. So, will it be in the resurrection of the dead? The body that is sown perishable will be raised imperishable. That means that which is put into the ground, its characteristic was that it was getting weaker and weaker and getting tireder and tireder, and it was decaying. That's being perishable. It is getting older and older, and it's seeing, is being shown in his body. But when it's raised different, and it's raised imperishable with greater glory, greater splendor than what it was when it was put into the ground. It is sown in dishonor. I mean, nobody parades around a dead body as if it was something really great to look at. Now, I've seen some strange things. I used to work in a company that processed film. That was back when cameras had film. And I used to strip the strips of film in the dark room, and every once in a while people would shout to everybody else in the company, come see, because people would have strange pictures. And we would all come running to find out what was the newest weird thing that people did. Well, in certain customs, I guess, in certain cultures, you'll find things that are just things that you don't understand. You don't understand why they do that. But there was a picture of a man in a casket. The casket was standing up, and then the whole family was standing beside it as if he was still alive. And they took the family picture. And so we found that to be a little strange. But that is not what we're talking about here, is it? He's talking about sown in dishonor. They were honoring that body as they were taking pictures with them. But that's not what we normally think about when we have a body that's dead. We honor that person, but we're not happy that that person's in that condition. But when it's raised, he talks about something incredibly honorable. It's raised in glory. Wow, that's splendor on steroids. It is sown in weakness and is raised in power. It is sown a natural body and it is raised a spiritual body. So he's talking to us about the fact that one day our bodies will be changed and they will be better than what they have ever been. They will be no longer perishable, but they'll be imperishable. They'll live forever. They will never grow old. They will never have injuries. They'll never get sick, never have skin rashes, never itch. Any of those things. These bodies will be incredible. And they will be raised in weakness, but they'll be raised in power. They will be put in the ground in dishonorable fashion. Not that people are dishonoring them, but there is nothing to be envied about them, but they will be raised in glory. So these things will happen. He says there is a natural body. That was a question that probably propped up in your mind when it said there is sown a natural body, but raised a spiritual body. What is the difference between a natural body and a spiritual body? The word that's used for a spiritual body is supernatural. It is a body that is supernatural. It is a body that is responsive to the Holy Spirit in every possible way. It is a body that is without sin. And to help us understand this, he gives us a comparison. He talks about the first Adam. That was Adam and Eve back in the beginning, he says. He says, so it is written that the first Adam became a living being. That was Adam and Eve and back in the Garden of Eden. The last Adam, that is Jesus. If you go to Romans chapter 5, that's where Paul teaches this doctrine that as Adam was a representative of all mankind and brought sin on everyone, Jesus is the second Adam who acted as a representative of all those who would believe in him, and he gives forgiveness, gives them new life. And so he's called the second Adam because they're both representatives. And so here he speaks of this last Adam who has become a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man was of the dust of the earth. That's how Adam was formed. The second man was from heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. That's all of us. And as the man from heaven, so also are those who are of heaven, those who belong to Christ and who will be changed into his likeness. For verse 49 says, just as we have borne the likeness of the earthly man, we shall now bear the likeness of the man from heaven. Do you want to know what the body is going to be like that we will receive? You look at Jesus after his resurrection. We don't know a whole lot about that body. We see some things that are difficult to explain. Jesus appearing in a room when the doors were locked, and it appears that he just came through the wall as if it wasn't there. Jesus going from one place to another instantaneously. You know, those are kinds of things that seem to give us indication that this was a different body, but there was also continuity. Continuity in the sense that people could recognize him and that he could eat and he was touchable. And they could hold him, and they could feel him, and things like that. In Philippians chapter 3, we're told about the same thing. It says that our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, that is Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, and that is incredible power, he brings everything in the universe under his own control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. So there you have it very directly. Our new bodies will be like that which Jesus has. We cannot inherit heaven without it. We're told in verse 50, I declare to you, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does perishable inherit the imperishable. It's sort of like if you're going to live in the sea, you have to become a fish. You can't live there the way you are now. To live in heaven, you need a body that is prepared for living in heaven. We can't go as we are. Therefore, this must happen for us to live with the Lord in heaven. He says in verse 51, listen, I tell you a mystery. We'll not all sleep. This is about when it's going to happen to us. We will not all sleep. That means that not all of us will die before he comes. But we will all be changed. All being those who have died before he comes and those who are still alive at the time of his coming. And then he describes that experience. He says, in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we, who are still alive at his coming, will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. That must happen. And when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and when the mortal has been made immortal, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Are you afraid of death? Are you afraid about what sort of things are happening in our country and in the world? Jesus has conquered death. And whether we die in those sorts of experiences, or whether we live, when he comes, none of us will be lost. For those who are dead in the ground will rise first. And those who are still alive will be caught up in the air with him, and we will all be changed. We will receive a new body. So he tells us that that's when the victory is declared. That's at the end of the time. That's the end of the judgments. That is the time of Jesus' second coming. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. You see, that's why we have death. It's because we sin. And he's talking to us, and then as we go to Revelation, about a place where there is no sin. And the law is what condemns us and convicts us. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through the Lord Jesus Christ by the very virtue of the fact that he takes our sin upon himself. So what is the conclusion? What do we take away from this? How does this affect our lives? He says, therefore, my dear brothers, stand outside your house and keep your eyes up. Don't do anything anymore because you don't need to. Because, you see, Jesus is coming and he's going to take you to be with himself. That isn't what it says here. It says, therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. In other words, continue being who God has made you to be. Continue loving your neighbor. Continue helping the sick. Continue seeking the lost. Continue worshiping God. Don't give up hope, because your hope is in the fact that he's coming again and he will resurrect those who belong to him. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. You will not finally be lost, and all that you thought you were living for be lost. He says your hope is solid because he will indeed resurrect us, and he will reward us following that resurrection, and we will live with him forever and ever. And then Revelation 21:1 says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And that's where we end today. I'm sorry. I wish I could go further. But next week when we come together, we'll talk about the new heaven and the new earth. Because the old earth passes away and there's no longer any sea. So we have much to look forward to. It's not about, you know, just living pie in the sky, far, you know, thinking about only about the future and what's happening in heaven, but standing firm now because of what he has promised that he will do. Looking forward to that new body. I'm trusting you are too. Every day when I wake up with the pains that I have, I'm thinking, man, I can't wait. At the end of C.S. Lewis's last battle, there's a word in which I think sounds incredibly helpful. It's talking about Aslan. Aslan in this story is always pictured as a lion. He is the image of the Lord Jesus Christ himself in this story. It's a fantasy story. And it says, as he spoke, he no longer looked to them like a lion. But the things that began to happen after that were so great and beautiful that I cannot write them. And for us, this is the end of all the stories. And we can mostly truly say that they all live happily ever after. But for them, it was only the beginning of the real story. All their life in this world and all of their adventures in Narnia had only been the cover and the title page. And now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. This is where we're headed. Let's pray together. Father, as we look around us, it is as you have told us. There is incredible suffering. There is incredible fear that is rising in many people's hearts. over the unpredictability of life in which we live. But you talk to us about an end to that and a new beginning, a beginning where there is no death, there is no pain, there is no suffering, and all tears are wiped away. And so, Lord, we look forward to that day. It gives us hope and strength for this day, knowing that whatever we do for you now will never be lost. It will never have no meaning, but will be rewarded by you. It will be also given strength by you, assured of your love and assured of your purposes in our lives. We thank you for what you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand and turn to 603. I refer to you as the Victory Celebration Hymn.
What a wonderful hymn it is. Let's stand and sing When We All Get to Heaven. 603.
Just want to remind you that these books are still available. If you'd like to take one with you, they're free. Take them along, okay? Not a sale, but I want you to be blessed by the things that you can read there. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your presence with us, for the hope that you've given us. And may we live in that hope, knowing that there is a time when you're coming to bring us home. Thank you so much, Father. We do pray also for our service this evening, for Mike and Karen, that they will be blessed in their coming to be among us. May we be blessed to hear of the things that your Holy Spirit is doing through them. Lord, we also want to pause and just ask for your mercy for those that have suffered greatly in these last days. In France, in Dallas, in Turkey, and other places in the world, Father, we ask that you would minister to the families of those who have lost their relatives and sorrow deeply. We ask that you would bring alongside others that know you and can bring hope to them. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.